Welcome to this Cyber Resilience Act, CRA, compliance training series. This module focuses on our penetration testing methodology for products with digital elements. In this session, we'll provide a clear, structured overview of how to design and conduct penetration tests that align with the CRA. Our goal? To help European small and medium-sized enterprises that manufacture products with a digital element understand and meet the CRA's pentesting requirements. Let's get started and see how this methodology can help you prepare for, coordinate and complete your product with a digital element pen test aligned with the CRA requirements. In this section, we'll cover the core purpose and objectives of the methodology. This methodology offers a standardized, yet flexible, approach to penetration testing for digital products. It ensures consistent outputs that manufacturers can use to demonstrate CRA compliance. Importantly, it's tailored for important Class 1, Class 2, and critical products. It is also applicable to products falling under the CRA's default category. But, for the default category products, testing may be performed with reduced frequency or scope, reflecting their generally lower risk profile and less critical usage contexts. Before we dive deeper, let's clarify who this methodology is meant for. How does the CRA define manufacturers? A manufacturer is any natural or legal person who develops or produces products with digital elements, or has such products designed and marketed under its name or trademark. This includes both large organizations and SMEs. While this approach applies broadly, we've specifically adapted it to be simple and clear for SMEs, making it accessible even if security resources are limited. This methodology focuses strictly on product-level penetration testing. It is not a general infrastructure or system-level assessment. We assume tests will be conducted in a controlled laboratory environment closely simulating real-world deployment. During Phase 1, we identify any constraints, such as ensuring testing does not disrupt ongoing operations. Understanding these limits up front helps keep the testing safe and effective. Next, we'll look at the recognized industry standards that form the foundation of our approach. This methodology integrates several internationally recognized standards. These include OSSTMM 3, which guides operational level security audits, the OWASP testing guide, focused on web security and APIs, the Penetration Testing Execution Standard, or PTES, which ensures structured engagement processes, and NIST SP 800-115, providing best practices for impact evaluation. These combined frameworks ensure our process is consistent, repeatable, and realistic. In addition, our approach has been designed to be fully aligned with CRA obligations. Let's now look at the methodology overview and the phases we'll be covering. This methodology is structured around five distinct phases, each crucial for thorough, CRA-compliant penetration testing. Each phase has specific activities, required inputs, and clear outputs, all linked to the relevant CRA Annex I requirements. Let's start with Phase 1, pre-engagement and planning. Phase 1 is needed to clearly define objectives and scope, align stakeholders, and establish safe testing conditions. We begin by defining the testing objectives and establishing the scope. This ensures testing is focused on the product's unique features and risk profile. We also address all legal, regulatory, and ethical considerations by securing necessary authorizations and defining clear boundaries. In this phase, several critical documents are produced. Document 1. Planning and Requirements Document, D1. This document outlines the testing objectives, scope, and specific requirements. It serves as the foundation for the engagement, ensuring all parties agree on what will be tested and how. Document 2. Contingency Procedures, D2, D2 describes the fallback plans and safety measures to minimize impact in case of unexpected events during testing. Document 3. Pre-test Risk Assessment and Stakeholder Alignment, D3. This document evaluates potential risks involved in testing and ensures all stakeholders understand and accept these risks. These outputs align the testing process with CRA Annex I and prepare the team for a safe and effective engagement. Let's move on to Phase 2, Intelligence Gathering and Reconnaissance. Phase 2 is essential to build a detailed profile of the target system, enabling targeted testing later. This phase involves collecting open-source intelligence and discovering system assets. Testers gather information to profile the target environment and develop realistic threat scenarios based on likely adversary behavior. The key outputs here are Document 4, External Vulnerability Report, D4, which catalogs vulnerabilities exposed to external attackers, including public interfaces and services. Document 5, Internal Vulnerability Report, D5, which details vulnerabilities discovered from an internal perspective, simulating an attacker with some level of access. These reports include vulnerability mappings and threat exposure ratings derived from the discovery process. The next phase results in finalized versions of the external and internal vulnerability reports, D4 and D5, documenting detailed risk ratings and attack feasibility. Next up is Phase 3, Testing Execution and Exploitation, where the simulated attacks begin. This phase focuses on actively further extending and exploiting the vulnerabilities discovered in Phase 2 to emulate real-world attacks. Both manual and automated techniques are employed, supported by AI-driven simulations and anomaly detection to enhance accuracy. Activities include exploiting weaknesses to gain unauthorized access, post-exploitation actions, such as lateral movement within the system, collecting evidence of impact, including proof of concept artifacts. Now, let's analyze the consequences of these findings in Phase 4, Impact Analysis and Reporting. In Phase 4, we assess the impact of attacks against identified vulnerabilities and prepare comprehensive documentation to support mitigation. Risk evaluation is based on the CIA triad, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. AI-based risk models may be applied to assign risk levels, factoring in exploitability and current threat intelligence. Key activities include evaluating business impact and risk levels, documenting findings and supporting technical evidence, recommending remediation and mitigation strategies. The outputs include risk evaluation report, comprehensive findings document, remediation recommendations, prioritized remediation action plan, regulatory compliance alignment report. The culminating output is the recommendations and remediation roadmap, D6, detailing corrective actions prioritized by urgency. Finally, we wrap up with Phase 5, post-engagement follow-up. This final phase verifies that all remediation efforts have been completed successfully. It involves retesting to confirm vulnerabilities have been resolved. The methodology encourages continuous improvement by incorporating lessons learned into future tests. Activities include verification and retesting, updating the testing methodology based on outcomes, applying lessons learned to enhance future engagements. The main output is the executive summary, D7, a clear, non-technical report designed to communicate risks, actions, and recommendations to stakeholders. Each penetration test engagement following this methodology produces a standard set of outputs, planning and requirements document. Contingency procedures, pretest risk assessment and stakeholder alignment, external vulnerability report, internal vulnerability report, recommendations and remediation roadmap, executive summary. These documents provide clarity, traceability, and support CRA compliance claims. Let's see how this methodology works in practice with a real-world example. Now, we'll apply the CRA-compliant penetration testing methodology to an identity management system, a product classified as Important Class 1 under the CRA. Let's see how the phases unfold in this context. Identity management system handle user authentication and access control, often integrating cloud components. CRA classifies identity management system as Important Class 1 products, requiring secure module integration, strong cryptography, and compliance with secure coding standards. This real-world test involves a small business with 15 employees using a cloud-based identity and access management system to control employee access to internal tools such as a customer relationship management platform, human resources portal, and business email system. The organization has no dedicated cybersecurity staff and is conducting a penetration test for the first time. Testers apply the CRA-compliant methodology to identify security weaknesses and provide actionable insights. The identity and access management system operates in a low-security environment.
There is basic password authentication across applications, inconsistent implementation of multi-factor authentication, and no central alerting or security information in event management. The penetration test simulates the perspective of an attacker in such an underprotected environment. Testers begin with a planning phase, reviewing system architecture provided by the client. The scope includes authentication logic, session timeout policies, password reset flows, account lockout controls, and integrations such as single sign-on. Testers perform reconnaissance by scanning web portals and identifying exposed login endpoints tied to internal services. Several inconsistencies are noted, such as authentication URLs that lack multi-factor authentication enforcement or reuse insecure token handling patterns. These findings feed directly into the exploitation phase. Testers use automated tools to simulate brute force login attempts on a discovered authentication portal. The absence of rate limiting, logging, or account lockout protections allows repeated login attempts to continue unchecked. Eventually, valid credentials are recovered, confirming that password protections are inadequate. During testing, no alerts or system logs are triggered, which means unauthorized access attempts could easily go unnoticed. These issues point to significant gaps in credential security, logging, and authentication controls. Findings are rated on likelihood and impact of unauthorized access. An attack may crash the service as well, resulting in a denial of service attack. Evidence such as screenshots, logs, and attack traces feed into the remediation strategy. Recommendations will probably focus on password policy strengthening and enhanced authentication protocols, but may reflect other weaknesses. Post-remediation testing confirms improvements, and lessons learned support ongoing security cycles. Pentesting is part of the product cycle, performed during the development and run processes. By ensuring you perform CRA-aligned pentesting practices from the start, your product becomes more secure and compliant, accelerating market readiness. Whether you're a manufacturer, SME innovator, or cybersecurity team, this pentesting methodology provides a clear, structured path forward in organizing and supervising penetration tests for your products with digital elements. Don't wait until the final stages to consider resilience. Early, smart planning saves resources, reduces risk, and builds trust. Find out more CRA compliance guidance, trainings, and automation tool on www.confirmate-project.eu. Subscribe and follow us on LinkedIn for timely updates.